summer internship projects. But there's nothing great about the projects. Projects are still in development phase. You may have to really work hard on this to reach a level wherein we can say that there is a real project. Otherwise, it won't be a project anymore. So these are the five projects. And
so data analytics for educational data.
So that's the first project. Yeah, three. See, previously we had data analytics. You know, it's not that data analytics had just started because of big data. It's not correct. The reason for big data, you know, analytics, the reasons are different. The reasons are because of these three things. That is volume. There's a volume. Transactions is not one transaction. You know, this one query. No, not that type of transaction. There's a volume in that. Terabytes, records, and then you know, tables and unstructured data. You know, so variety will tell you, unstructured data, structured data, semi-structured, so different types of data available. Even Wikipedia, you know, unstructured or structured, semi-structured. You know, data could be from anywhere, not only from a system, data also could be from cloud or any, I mean, from Google APIs or anywhere. So you have to find where is the data. So how do you make that connection? So how does Facebook work? Right, so Facebook has got partners where it collects data, then you have your social media running here, and then somehow it's related and it says that you also have an account here somewhere, which you never disclose to Facebook, right? Am I right? Or you tell Google, or Google tells you that you have an account here also. You say, how do you know? So that's not internal data, it's data from everywhere, metadata.
Velocity, batch, running in batch, you know, not just
small, near time. Batch analytics is something like you have huge records and you need to compute something from those records. So that's the general notion of batch analytics, which happened some 20 years back, where the data was mostly taken in a historical form, which was kept. You know, data warehousing systems where data was kept in the warehouse, then you do an ETL and then you say, I have this, now it is going to take another 2 days only to run one query, and then I get my results. So that's a batch thing. But now this batch is becoming different. You know, you're not going to work on huge data. You may want to work on a substantial subset of the data. Maybe if you have exabyte of data, actual data with you, you may want to work on 1 terabyte meaningful data, and that's batch. Okay, so this is my batch, or batch mode, wherein you actually push in the data at one time, this much, and you know, because you know some schemas already defined, some schemas are evolving, you know, many things are happening. So unstructured data gets converted to structured form sometimes, you know, you define such schemas, and then your data, you see it's coming from somewhere, streaming and flowing onto your system,
and now you want to do some analytics on it, right?
So people may want real time. Real time is something like
in a second. I mean,
cannot wait. Stock market analysis, real time, right? You get data. How do you get it? It's possible. Okay. So
in-memory data management systems built by Hasso-Plattner Institute, that's in Germany.
So there's a book also, by the way, they have written a book, and they talk about analytics being done in the memory rather than on the disk. So you don't read from the disk all the time. So you keep everything in memory. The data is compressed or encoded in some form that you know, it can fit in the memory. Now memory is not expensive. Memory, you can buy 128 gig or even 1 terabyte of memory is possible nowadays, right? So you put everything in memory and you don't put anything on the disk, and that's how
it's possible sometimes to get real-time analytics,
even streams. Okay, so these are the things possible, the possibilities.
You have a mix of something, then you are here.
But if you do not have more memory, you are there. So you are going back to 20 years.
Right. You have more memory, you are going that side.
It's like that.
What I'm saying is, this is an ETL phase here. ETL is
extract transform and load. So you extract the data, okay? So I will go through it. So what is an E phase? So first you need to acquire the data. So where is the data? This is the data, this. Okay, so what do I do with the data? So I need, I need to extract it somehow. I mean, extract something, right? Some based on certain schema that I need. Okay, I may not want to extract everything. I may need to clean the data. Cleaning is something like where you have null values, what are you going to do? Right? So, or some other condition appears and you are feeling that your final result will get affected, because if you don't clean it, then there is a problem. So you need to clean the data, you need to annotate sometimes. So some schemas are missing, or you want to populate something in the data, you are allowed to do that. So that's an extraction phase, and you know exactly what you have done because you have recorded it, that this and this is what I have done on that data. And when I actually do the final interpretation or analysis phase, that time I can remove those things, okay, which I have I created something in the data which is not it was required to be there, and now I don't need it, you know, something like that. So then I have a transformation phase. I need to transform it in different form, because I have structured here, I have unstructured. So how do I, if I want everything structured, I need to do something. So that's transformation, okay. Aggregation, if you want, I mean, you may want to integrate. So that's integration, because you would like to integrate one set of structured and one set of semi-structured information, or another set of say unstructured information. You want to put it at one place, and that's exactly what you want, okay. So that is one what gets loaded finally. So that's a load phase. In the load phase, that is the data, you have a whole metadata of your system, and that which is loaded, and now you know what to do, because you are going to fire queries. So aggregation, representation, so these are all the terms, jargon, so don't worry, you know, this is not, in the simplest sense, you just extract something, you transform something for your own use, wherever comma is not there, you put comma, like that. And then you load somewhere, that's it, in the simplest way. If you go little bit more and more complex, if you have actually seen data, how it looks like, somewhere comma is not there, what you'll do? You have to do something, no? You understand? So then you do some analysis, as I said, you have already written those queries, and these are the queries which are important for you, and then you need to analyze after it has been loaded, and you predict something. I mean, you had predicted well earlier that this is what could have happened for this data, and you see and you match and you say that, okay, my analysis is correct. Somewhere I had predicted, or I had hypothesized, and now I feel that it is correct. Okay, so that's analysis. And modeling, I mean, modeling is generally used where you would want to you mean to build a model is more about understanding the behavior of the system, actually. So the behavior of the data. So if you say that something is being affected by some other data, some other sources available, and from that you derive a conclusion saying that this is dependent on that, something is dependent, something is independent, that's a model you build finally. Okay, the model is you can say mathematical model or something like that. It's a model. Model is simple equation. Y is equal to sine of x. Sine of x is a model. Simple. Okay, so there may be many other things. Okay, statistics involved to understand that this is my model. And then you do some interpretation. I will not go on to interpretation because you can interpret it very well. So tools for big data analytics. One month back I felt Hadoop was the right thing to do, but today I'm feeling Hadoop is not good enough. Actually, Hadoop is widely used, and Hadoop is mostly a disk-based system. So every time it does something, it writes something into the disk, which is not good, right? Disk is slower. How do you get real-time analytics or something like that? Is it? I mean, it will be difficult to if your stock market was running on Hadoop. I don't think it would have been very difficult.
It's okay with Facebook because they
can. You can say that, oh, I have not received this. You sent a message on my Facebook account. How do I know I should be receiving or not? You know, how do I know? You don't care, right? Do you care? When somebody sends you a message on Facebook, you get it only when you get it, right? You see it only when you get it. So it's not very important in that. So you will always get it somewhere. Though they have some, it's not correct even to say that Facebook actually ran on Hadoop and they did some re-engineering underneath. And they have pretty good system now. The huge clusters are, I mean, almost 5,000 and above machines do exist. And Facebook collect almost 5 petabytes of data every day. Every day, 5 petabytes of data, whatever you are doing. You know why people do that? You may ask me this question because it's a norm that any data which is available or which is being collected has to be kept somewhere archived. You know, many companies did that before. Those who operated on, you know, huge data collection, who had their client base, you know, huge database. So they did that. And some of the CEOs or some of those high officials, they were always asked, what do you do with the data? They said, we don't know. It may be useful after 10 years. So it's like that. So no data is to be thrown out. Remember that. So that is the. This has been followed for last since the time, you know, the data has been put in the system. Data is not thrown out. Data is always archived somewhere. Okay. So don't think that old data can be thrown out. It's not correct. So they are historical data. They are important, like your history.
So you have a distributed file system there.
It's a file system with little bit enhanced features wherein you have why it's called distributed because the objects are replicated across, so much of the storage space allocated to those objects, you know, where the data exists, they have been replicated to many places, and Hadoop is supposed to run on commodity machines, remember. So don't ask for a supercomputer if you want to do a project. Okay, so small machines, 5-10 machines you take together and you should be able to demonstrate. So, and then the success actually came from map reduce thing. It's just the map thing and the reduce. I will not go into the details of map reduce. It's more about mapping something, you know, key value pairs are there. They're just mapped onto one. It's like saying I have so many things to do here. I take a bunch here and I tell him, please do sorting. Now if I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 people who can sort, I may need one or two people, not more than that, to merge. Okay, so it's map and then reduce. In reduce phase you do the merging and all those things. So, it depends on what you want, you know, every time you will not do merge and every time you will not do search.
It depends on what you exactly want. I'm giving you an example. So you have Hive. Hive is high level way of, you don't have to write MapReduce programs if you have Hive.
And Hive is very much like SQL, but not exactly like SQL. Remember, Hive is supposed to run much more than what SQL can do. But not in conventional sense, where SQL can do more than Hive. Okay, so some much of the syntax of Hive is very similar to SQL 92.
So that's the standard in which it has been compliant.
So in that, these are the queries which are supposed to run. Okay, and there are other queries like suppose I have JSON objects. Okay, or I have some other objects. I can actually query those objects rather than writing a flat table like structure. So I don't need to create a structure, okay, flat table structure. I have a JSON object which is a hierarchical object, okay, hierarchy. There's a hierarchy. If you have seen XML files, right, in a hierarchical form. So some of them do not exist, somewhere it exists, right? So hives do have such queries which can interpret such objects like JSON, and then it can extract information based on the query, the way you write, and you can create views and whatever. So that's a, it's mostly like NoSQL as well as SQL. So do exist both of them, and I have seen both of them do equally run well, not bad. So then you have Mahout, actually, I think Pushpak Burange in the morning, he actually talked about Hive and Hadoop somewhere, and then Mahout, I think he missed out Mahout actually. These are all Apache projects. The Mahout is one of the Apache's project, and Mahout is more about machine learning models do exist in Mahout, so that you don't have to write again, keep on write. So they are already available, so you just use them. Okay, so you want to do something with the data, you don't want to do predictive analysis, you want to do clustering, you want to do many things which are available in data mining is available in Mahout. So it's a library, like the other library, RapidMiner, and the other one, Weka, which is being also used. So this is like that. Okay, so it's a library for doing some data mining type of job. And Nime is, I don't know why I fell in love with Nime, because I found it interesting, and there's nothing great about Nime. It's more of a, that's what I feel. I've never installed Nime, but I feel it is much, could be useful. It's a front end system, okay. It's a front end interface for your data analytics, for your data analytics. So you don't have to write that system. So that system is available. Okay. So then, so I want to see how does it look like. So I have not seen. Till date, I have seen only Hive and Mahout at the most. So Nime is something which I want to see. Is it difficult to use? Is it flexible? Or is it going to work across different platforms? Okay, that's also important, because today is Hadoop. Tomorrow it may be something else. Okay, we don't know, right? So presently it's Hadoop. Okay, so don't worry. And then you have Saras. Saras is without writing code, you can create some big data workflow, and such workflows can be mapped onto the underlying query system. Okay, so once you couple them, you can shuffle them here and there. But this is still in the development phase. Remember, there is only one case study which is done on Saras. So if you are going to use it, be careful, because there is only one case study, and you may have to work more on understanding what is a workflow. So first you have to know what is a workflow. Okay, so we'll come to that later. Okay, not now, today. So there are interesting questions. Okay, so how many students have never viewed learning resource A? Okay, so you may say it's okay question. So the first thing is not to ask like, you can do something magical. Saying that I want to ask a question which cannot be answered by your data. Don't do that. Okay, ask a question much closer to the data, and then you build other ones based on this. Okay, don't say that I want to know how many students would ever take up a job in TCS. That will be useless to answer, right? Because you don't have information. Get closer to the system and say that this is the information that I want. So very, quite simple, it's not very difficult in the beginning. So you have to run some queries, you have to write. You don't write, you will not get anything. So it's important. So how many students have never viewed learning resource A? Good, very simple. If students do well on activity B, do they also do well on activity C? And that will give you some information that somewhere there is, that is up to the analytic team to understand why such a thing is important. Generally, programmers are not allowed to ask even these questions. Programmers are just given, I want this information, can you give me? So you are actually playing a dual role, okay? So anyway, I mean, we can sort out that matter later.
If students solve exercise E, do they solve exercise E?
I'll just go faster, okay? What is the average mark on quiz G got by students who have viewed resource F? And like this questions.
I mean, questions are interesting. So I'm not saying what I have written is interesting.
I'm saying that questions are interesting and you need to write more and more like this.
Okay, recommendation system. So you have content-based
recommendation systems like based on preferences. This is my preference,
and I say Google recommends me
something based on my preference.
That's the first one. The second one is
collaborative filtering. That means somebody has bought a book on Flipkart, and based on his preference or based on the sequence that he bought a book. He bought that book and then he bought something else. Now Flipkart is also asking me to buy something. So based on other people's preferences.
Okay, so and there are hybrid approaches. So these are
not very difficult. I mean not very useful. Okay, just you have to know.
Then adaptive learning system. So why I'm coming to adaptive learning? So
a recommendation system is one, but it is not complete because it doesn't have the knowledge about what happens between two different concepts, you know, domain concepts. So that's not enough. And if we need to represent this with the previous, you know, just recommending, so based on it, it will be like a graph. And in graph, you may not be able to handle so much information. You would need a structure which will map to a graph. So that structure, I am not going to define it here.
I'm just going to tell you, now imagine the student requires
a highly personalized tutoring system that after these he gets some marks and then he gets a particular activity, and then after doing this activity he gets something else, but not everybody gets the same thing, you know, everybody's flow is different. So that's all is this all about.
So that is highly adaptive
navigation. So you can go to any direction you want to say, I want to learn physics, I want to learn mathematics, I want to learn something else. But the path will be chosen by the system and given to you that this is the path. Now, how do you choose such a path?
There is a knowledge dependencies between
domain objects. So if you know something, then you can be say, it can be said that you know something about this based on this. Now that needs to be codified in the system, okay? And there is a model which allows you to code such a thing in your system. That's fuzzy cognitive map. So I'm not going to get into the into that fuzzy cognitive mapping and all those things. So that we'll see later. There are many papers which you can read. Now question needs to be addressed. If a student learn the concept A, what is her his knowledge level on the dependent domain object B? Okay, so something A is dependent on B, and B is there's a dependency relation here. So if something if one knowledge is increased in one direction, do you see an increase of knowledge in the other direction, in the other domain concept? Okay, so like for loop and while loop, so you can consider for loop. If you know for loop, maybe you know while loop, or you know while loop, maybe you know for loop. Okay, so that is for you to decide. And student knowledge of concept A and B and C improves, you know, you can also have multiple dependencies A, B and C, then something is dependent on something. You can enforce, you can look into this type of questions, you know. And is your system going to answer such questions? That's more important. So your requirement phase will tell you, like, you know, this is what we want, and okay, there will be SRS and all those things that they will be doing.
If the student has misconceptions on a domain concept A, how is his knowledge level of the dependent concepts B, C and D affected? So somewhere is a misconception. Can you say that
there's a misconception somewhere else? Yeah, so it's almost looking very similar actually, but there's more to it, why, how you can do it. And that almost I have listed around 30 papers. How many? 30-40, I don't remember. You can just go through it. Third project, so load testing and benchmarking for big data. So earlier times we had big data is not about recent phenomena. It has happened and now is happening more because, as I said, there are three V's which are important. And you start from something like an OLTP, online transaction processing, where you know, it's like a banking system where people are you know, debiting, crediting, you know, all these things happening. That's OLTP mostly. So generally in OLTP we had benchmarks called TPCC,
ad hoc querying. So ad hoc is, you know what is
the meaning of ad hoc. If you don't know, then you can look into the dictionary. So TPCC is actually a transaction processing council,
so which happened long back, where industry and academia got together and then they built a system, some sort of a benchmark for systems.
You know, they want to say that this machine is this much having performance or price per performance, or you know, they have some metrics. So this machine is this much powerful, that's it. Okay, how do you do that? You just don't load that machine with huge files and say that, oh, it can take all of my files. What happens to the processing? Okay, so the benchmark is having a mixed workload sometimes. So
TPC generally was focused
on OLTP type of transactions where only, like, you know, customers firing requests for debit, credit, you know, transfer, you know, all the time it is
like an ad hoc. Then you
had OLAP, online analytical processing, where the historical data was, I mean, put in a warehouse and then the analytics are done later, and whether to know such a system could do analytics was important, so the benchmark was introduced. So you know, so you understand.
Flexible latency analytics, now
these are the phases that are happening, these and this coming.
We should be focusing mostly somewhere here,
but we cannot leave these two people here, because they also have some history to tell us, and then some of the things are important in them.
Okay, so the lessons learned from TPCC
and the TPCCH are important, and they need to be carried forward for understanding this type of things. So here you have flexible latency analytics.
Low latency desirable, but
not essential. Right, so you may need a system with low latency, but it's not say that foolproof to say that it's zero latency or point something. It can vary from this point to this point. Okay, for a full load, the full data set that you have in the system. So you know, if you want to expand, you know, if you want to do capacity planning of your system, you know how much more to put, right? How much hardware to put? How much memory to put, probably. Then interactive analytics, this is generally of daily cycle, you know, what happens, there are some patterns, you know, like, you know, on Facebook somebody is doing this, somebody is doing something else, these are the patterns, okay, these are daily patterns, or stock market, daily patterns, okay, that type of workload, that the queries are such that this is the workflow pattern which falls in this category. So that's called interactive analytics. There's nothing great about these words. Okay, the some sort of pattern. They have low computational latency also, but it's slightly broader than OLAP.
That you may come to know later. Semi-streaming
analytics, recent data rather than historical data. So you don't consider the old data. You just consider recent data that you have collected for last five days or 10 days, probably recent data. Okay, then you want to do some schema discovery also. What is the schema for that data? Okay, for example, a click rate statistics for a product. So for a particular product, you will be interested in knowing how far is my product clicking, right? Is it going well in the market? Right, so these are the things that are handled. This type of patterns are different. So all are very different, by the way. Okay, so this you will understand only when you go into by looking at the workload, whether it's a read workload, write workload, what are the combinations possible, you know, patterns.
Your data benchmark has to be representative. That means it should be
possible to demonstrate with a real life example. Okay, so that's more important. It has to be representable. Okay, then it should be relevant. It should not be about fiction, science fiction things, right? It should be relevant to a particular domain probably. Okay.
Portable, of course, because Hadoop goes, something else
come, it should still be there. Okay. Scalable.
It should scale. Scalable in the sense,
if I actually want to have a benchmark of a cluster size, a number of clusters, say cluster size of 50,000 clusters, and if you ask me today, I will not be able to give 50,000 clusters. But your benchmark has to be such that if I put it on 5 clusters and then I do that multiplication and something else, you should be able to assure me that this, after multiplying, it is going to run on these many machines. So you understand? You understand? So that's called scalability. Okay, so there should not be, if it's running on 5, it has to run on 50,000, whatever is it. Right, so such a data exists, then it has to run on such machines.
It should be simple, because complicated is not good. Challenges, data generation, structured and unstructured,
multiplexing, because MapReduce workload, you know, it's not mostly high queries that are running, or not just structured queries are running. It is also about programs written by some tools which are been written in a MapReduce format. And those also need to be explored, but maybe we'll not go into it. But you know, mostly query-like framework will be more interested. But actual benchmark, full-blown benchmark should have all of these things. Very important. Processing generation. So you need to generate what you want to do. You want to only read, or you want to only write. What do you want to do? I mean, or is there a pattern that you want to follow? So what patterns, right? And scaled down workloads, I just now explained what is a scaled down workload. So for 50,000 cluster, can you scale it down to this much and you still say that it is exactly going to perform on that scale. Empirical models for workload traces, from workload traces, that is you are building models from those traces. That means your workload generation should be able to take care of generating those type of workloads, which if you find in real life that such a workload exists somewhere, then my workload should be able to generate such a thing. Okay, so the processing generation should understand those type of workloads also. So those can be broken down into small steps, and then you can generate those things.
So here EDX is the system,
edX platform that generally people say edX or EDX, and then you have Moodle, which has been used extensively. Now there's a lot of data on Moodle. Can we push them on EDX platform? Or if there is a lot of data on EDX, can we push on Moodle? In some cases it may be useful to do something on this and something on EDX platform, right? So is it possible that you know, if you have a scenario where you have a centralized system and then distributed nodes which are located far away as a remote nodes, and if you want to synchronize some data, and in the centralized system you have just EDX installation, and in the remote installation you have say Moodle, because Moodle is very common. Okay, so in many colleges you may have Moodle installations coming to IIT Bombay, like the T10KT program, which is running, right? So you must have heard about 10,000 teachers training, right? So can we have EDX as a centralized system and then Moodle distributed across? Okay, these are the questions need to answer.
This is the code blocks ID.
You might have heard about,
maybe not, but it's just an IDE.
Which gives you capability to run, say, C programs or C++ or Python or any of this program. So for a beginner level, say first year, you know, they are coming and they don't know, oh, what is this? And they seek Eclipse or NetBeans, they get scared. So something which is very simple is good for them. So now that also looks very difficult. So now we have thought of simplifying it. Okay, written in C++ and whatever.
Features, create project, this, that,
is there on Ubuntu also, it's there on Windows, and we needed something cross-platform, not just running on Windows. So Windows, Ubuntu, because there's a problem in other colleges where they only have Windows machine. Now here you have Linux machine, so that's a that was an important thing, decision point, why this one and why not something else, okay, that was chosen. So create here, what we need is very simple. It may be, it may look very simple in the beginning, but I don't think it is that simple to do, but it is simple paradoxically, okay. So what is important here is just create a, so there's a problem, it's not a big problem, but I will tell you, there's a problem wherein every time when you say new, it creates a project, and in that project you have to build and all those things. So when you are a kid, like first year kid coming for programming, okay, so they get scared, I mean, what the hell is this, build every time. So like Turbo C++ you might have used, right? There is no build, just write program, run, execute, compile, something comes. So like that. So not only that, there may be other features, extension. Now you have to find out what could be those extensions. So okay, it has also been integrated with Simple CPP, the package developed by Abhiram Ranade, IIT Bombay here. So there are one MTech student working on it, and so there are two or three project staff probably. Yeah. So you may get help from them. And here it is more about, this is a turtle actually, this is a turtle, the red thing is a turtle. Turtle just moves and creates all these things. So the code is very simple, move forward 30 degrees, 40 degrees, 60 degrees, like that. So code is not very difficult. They don't have to write int, main and all those things. They don't have to even read any value. They just say forward 90, backward something, and left 90 something, and then is that simple as that. That's a code, okay. So first year, no, I mean, you have to be very cautious. You give them more dose, they will sleep. So this was introduced, and then it moves slowly to C++. It's a different way of teaching, okay. So in that context, we need code blocks, for such execution. This has already been integrated, but more work is yet to be done. We have to understand how there are some problems, bugs here and there, you know, they remain always. So it has to run, means run. So simple one click installation is more important in this project. So the current interface is not friendly for a novice person. Yeah. So all these things you can read maybe later. Source code available, everything is available. And then this is our link. Oh, everything is over. So this is our wiki where we have lots of projects which are been stated, and you know, so many things are there. So this has been written by human people, humans. It's not generated by a computer. Okay. So some of them may be useful, some of them will be useless for you. So don't think that everything will be useful. Okay, and then there is another one,
which is your summer internship. That's the page. So we'll be creating a lot of.
Maybe we'll give you an account on this page, and then you will be writing like this. Okay, something good, presentable.
So these are the references. They are very important.
Okay.
Thank you so much. Thank you.